Recorded Books presents an unabridged recording of Monday the Rabbi Took Off by Harry Kellerman, narrated by George Guidall. This book is copyrighted 1972, Harry Kellerman. This recording is copyrighted 1998 by Recorded Books. Monday takes Rabbi David Small on a private exodus to Israel for a much-needed rest. But where Rabbi Small goes, so goes trouble, and the Middle East is no exception. And now, Monday the Rabbi Took Off.
Chapter 1. From the sofa in the living room, where she was immersed in the Sunday paper, Miriam heard the door between the breezeway and the kitchen open and close. She called out, "David?" And when her husband came into the room, "Mr. Raymond called just after you left. It sounded important." Rabbi David Small nodded, rubbing his hands from the cold. He crossed the room to stand in front of the radiator.
"I saw him at the temple."
"You didn't wear your coat?" she said.
"I just had to walk from the car to the vestry door of the temple. And you've been having colds all winter. Just one cold."
Although in good health, Rabbi Small was thin and pale and had a kind of nearsighted scholarly stoop which made him seem older than his 35 years. His mother was always urging Miriam to coax him to eat. "But it's lasted all winter. Was it about the contract he wanted to see you?" He shook his head.
"No, it was to tell me that the board had voted not to hold the congregational Seder this coming Passover."
She could see that he was disturbed. "But it's not for 4 months yet."
"Four and a half months," he corrected her. "But there's nothing like being beforehand. He told me so that as superintendent of the religious school, I could inform the principal not to start coaching the children for their part in the service. That's called going through channels, like when I was a chaplain in the army. I had to tell Pastor Belson anything I wanted rather than talk to the colonel directly."
She could not fail to notice the bitterness in his tone. "Did he say why they decided not to hold it?"
"Not until I asked him. He said the last 2 years we lost money on the affair."
She looked up at him. "Does it bother you?"
"It bothers me that I wasn't invited to discuss it with the board. I've got over being bothered about not sitting in on board meetings, although after 6 years where each new board invited me to attend, the failure of this board to ask me is rather pointed. But this question of the Passover is so peculiarly within the area of the rabbi's jurisdiction, you'd think they'd want to know my views. If I am not to pass on matters of this sort, then what is my function here? Am I just a functionary in charge of ceremonials? Do they think..."
"But are you sure it was intentional, David?" she asked anxiously. He was so irritable of late. She tried to mollify him.
"They're new at the game. Maybe they just don't realize." "New at the game? They've been in office for 3 months now. And if they are in doubt about what is proper, there are people they can ask." "No, it's their entire attitude. They're in control, and I'm just an employee. Take the matter of my contract."
"Did he mention it?" she asked quickly.
"He did not."
"And you didn't either?"
"I mentioned it when it was due to expire," he said stiffly, "and that should be sufficient. Do you expect me to keep asking them? Am I supposed to wheedle it out of them?"
"But you're working without a contract."
"So? So they could fire you. They could give you a month's notice telling you that your services were no longer required." "I suppose they could. And I could do the same to them. I could notify them that I was leaving."
He smiled impishly.
"I'm rather tempted."
"Oh, you wouldn't." He left the radiator to pace the floor.
"Why not? It might be a good idea now I think of it. What would I lose? The few months to the end of the year? If they haven't given me a contract so far, it can only mean that they have no intention of reappointing me next year. Why else haven't they talked to me about it? Why else haven't they asked me to attend board meetings? And this today, just telling me that they're not going to hold the community seder? Yes, I'm sure that's what they have in mind. I am supposed to go through the motions for the rest of the year, marrying people, making little speeches at bar mitzvahs, giving my sermons on Friday night services. Then they'll notify me that for next year they are planning to make a change. Well, why not beat them to the punch?
Oh, they wouldn't, Miriam protested. They couldn't get away with it. Mr. Wasserman and all your friends would put up a fight.
Well, I'm not so sure that I want a fight. Why should I have to fight? How long before I am accepted? I've been here 6 years now. I'm on my 7th year, and there's been a crisis about my job almost every year. They've either tried to fire me or done something that left me no choice but to resign. I'm sick of it. It shouldn't be a condition of a man's employment that he should have to spend his time and energy just to keep his job. His energies should go into doing the work that the job involves.
Well, Miriam pointed out, the last board was planning to give you a life contract and a year sabbatical leave as well.
I heard rumors to that effect, and I suppose I would have accepted it if they had, he said moodily. And yet, what good is a life contract? It binds me, but it doesn't bind them. Any time they want to get rid of me, they have only to propose something outrageous that I couldn't live with, and I'd resign. Isn't that what happened when I made a rabbinic decision on the matter of burying poor Isaac Hirsch, and Mort Schwartz, who was president at that time, overrode me and ordered the body exhumed? Well, if you remember, that was during the first year of my 5-year contract, and I had no choice but to resign.
But they didn't accept your resignation, Miriam said.
Oh, they would have, all right, if it hadn't been for the Gorowskis, whom they were honeying up to. And only last year didn't Ben Gorfinkel actually tell me he was going to pay me off for the few remaining months of my contract and fire me right in the middle of the year?
Yes, but he and his friends on the board thought you were turning their kids against them. It was just a power play. I'm sure they wouldn't have gone through with it. Your friends on the board, Wasserman and Becker and the others, would have stopped it.
But Wasserman and Becker didn't stop it, he said. The best they could do was to offer me a job in another congregation they were thinking of starting up. Only when those same kids got involved in a murder case did it save my job, and that same Becker, I might add, was the man who led the opposition to me the very first year I was here and was all for dropping me when not only my job but my neck was at stake.
Oh, David, Miriam reproved him, that's ancient history. Becker's been as strong a backer for you as Wasserman ever since. You surely don't hold his opposition the first year against him.
I don't hold the opposition of any of them against them, he said. Neither Becker nor Schwartz nor Gorfinkel. They were all doing what they thought was for the best. Maybe the only one I should resent is Jacob Wasserman.
Miriam looked at him incredulously.
Wasserman? Why, he's been your friend from the beginning. He's the one who brought you here and kept you here against all opposition.
The rabbi nodded.
Well, that's what I mean. He's been too good to me. Maybe if that first year he had gone along with the majority opinion, I would have left here and got another job with another congregation. Maybe I've had to fight for my job here because I don't really belong. If after 6 years I still have to fight for my job, maybe it's the wrong job. Maybe another congregation.
But they're all like this, David, Miriam said. All the suburban congregations.
Then maybe it's me. Maybe I'm not flexible enough. Maybe I don't belong in the rabbinate at all, at least running a congregation. Maybe I ought to be in teaching or research or organizational work.
He sat down on the sofa and faced her.
Do you remember last Passover, Miriam? When we were sure I was through here and we decided that instead of hunting around for another job right away, we'd go to Israel instead?
So? The hint of a smile crossed his face.
So why don't we do it? If they can send me packing with a month's notice, why can't I leave with the same notice to them?
You mean resign your job? She was visibly shocked at the idea. Oh, not necessarily resign. I could ask for a leave of absence. And if they didn't grant it? I'd take it just the same. I'm tired and fed up and sick of this place. Do you realize that we've been here 6 years and I haven't had a vacation in all that time? In the summer, things slow down. The religious school is closed and there are no holidays or Friday evening services, but there are weddings and bar mitzvahs and people get sick and expect me to come to visit them and people come to see me about things that are troubling them. But except for an occasional weekend, we haven't been away at all. I've got to get away where I can be with myself for a while. He smiled. And in Israel, it would be warm. I suppose we could take one of those three-week tours, she said, considering. We could see the sights, and I don't want to see the sights, he retorted. They're either new buildings or the remains of old ones or holes in the ground. I want to live in Jerusalem for a while. We Jews have been yearning for Jerusalem for centuries. Every year at Passover and Yom Kippur, we say, next year in Jerusalem. Last Passover, when we said it, we really meant it. We really thought we would go. At least I did. All right, now is our chance. I have no contract binding me. But the board would regard it as the equivalent of resigning, she said. And to give up one's job? Well, suppose they do. We're young yet and can afford to take chances. Miriam looked at him apprehensively. But for how long? Oh, I don't know, he said easily. 3-4 months, longer maybe. Long enough to feel we were living there, not just visiting. But what would you do there? She asked. What do other people do there? Well, the people that live there work, and tourists are kept busy just sightseeing. Oh, if you're worried about how I'd keep busy, I could finish my Ibn Ezra paper for the quarterly. I've done all the research, I've got all my notes. What I need now is lots of uninterrupted time to write it. She looked at him, his face eager, so like little Jonathan pleading for some special privilege. More, she felt his desperate need. This isn't something you've just thought of, David. You've been thinking about it for some time, haven't you? All my life. No, but I mean, he faced her directly. Last year, when it looked as though I were through here, I thought we could go before I started looking for another job. When else would we get the chance? Then, when it turned out that this job was going to continue, I suppose I should have been glad that I was going to continue to draw a salary, but I wasn't. I'd had my heart set on going. And now I can't get it out of my mind. But to give up a job, I'll be able to get another when we come back, he said. And the chances are I won't have this one next year anyway. She smiled. All right, David. I'll write to my Aunt Gittel. Now it was his turn to look surprised. What's she got to do with it? Miriam put down the newspaper and folded it neatly beside her. I've followed you, David, in every important decision. When you turned down that job in Chicago that paid so much money because you didn't like the kind of congregation it seemed to be, I agreed. Although we were living on my salary as a typist, and whatever you could pick up in the way of an occasional holiday job in some small town. And then there was the job in Louisiana that you didn't want, and the job of assistant rabbi in Cleveland that paid more than most regular jobs for rabbis just graduating because you said you didn't want to subordinate your thinking to another rabbi. And when you wanted to resign your job here during the Schwartz regime, I went along, even though I was carrying Jonathan at the time and wasn't too keen on having to move to another town and find a place to live with a new infant. And now, you want to take a chance on losing this job so you can go and live in Jerusalem for a while. Again, I'll follow your lead. You're in charge of grand strategy, but you're not so good on tactics. If we're going to live in Jerusalem for several months, we'll have to have a place to stay. We can't live in a hotel for all that time. We can't afford it. Besides, in a hotel, you're always a visitor rather than a resident. So I'll write my Aunt Gittel, who's been living in Israel since the days of the British occupation. I'll tell her what we're planning and see if she can find us an apartment to rent. But she lives in Tel Aviv, and I want to stay in Jerusalem.
You don't know my Aunt Guidall.
Chapter 2. Bert Raymond wrapped the meeting to order.
I think we can probably dispense with the reading of the minutes of the last meeting. We didn't do much, as I recall.
Ben Gorfinkel raised his hand.
I'd like to hear the minutes, Mr. Chairman, he said evenly.
Oh, well, sure, Ben. Will you read the minutes, Barry?
Well, Bert, I mean, Mr. Chairman, I didn't get around to writing them up. I mean, I got my notes, but it's like in rough draft.
Well, that's all right, Barry. I'm sure Ben will overlook any little mistakes in grammar.
What I was going to say is that not having it in final form, and since we didn't decide on anything special last meeting, I didn't think it worthwhile bringing my notes.
The president was a tall, nice-looking young man, a good guy that everyone liked, and no one would think of embarrassing needlessly. He was obviously uncomfortable at the secretary's negligence. Gorfinkel shrugged his shoulders.
I guess if nothing happened, it doesn't make any difference.
With this new board, there were so many major things to object to, it seemed fruitless to jib at a little matter like not reading the minutes.
Okay, said the president gratefully. Then let's get on with the important business of this meeting. What's your pleasure in the rabbi's letter?
Again, Gorfinkel raised his hand.
I guess I must have missed something last meeting. I didn't hear about any letter from the rabbi.
The president was contrite. Gee, that's right, Ben. You don't know about it. I got it during the week, and I talked to some of the boys about it, so I assumed everyone knew. I got this letter from the rabbi asking for a leave of absence for 3 months, starting the first of the year.
May I see the letter?
Actually, I don't have it with me, Ben. But there's nothing in it, just what I said. You know, please regard this as a request for a 3-month leave of absence, that kind of thing, just a straight business letter.
He gave no reason for his request? Gorfinkel asked.
No, just what I told you. I tell you, it's a ploy, interrupted Stanley Agronaut. He's not interested in a leave of absence. What he's interested in is a contract. He sends us this letter, so we got to go to him and say, what gives, Rabbi? Then he says he wants to take off for 3 months. So we say, but Rabbi, you can't take off 3 months in the middle of the year like this. You got a job here. So he plays Mickey the Dunce and says, oh, have I? I don't have no contract. Then we got to kind of make it up to him and explain how we haven't had a chance to get around to the matter of contract and how we're sorry and all that crap. And that's supposed to put us on the defensive, see? It's just a ploy.
So what if we say no? Demanded Arnold Bookspan. When you showed me that letter, Bert, I said right away it was an ultimatum. He's not asking us, he's telling us. Now, if he's a bona fide employee of the temple, he can't take off just like that. And if he can take off just like that, then as I see it, he's not a bona fide employee of the temple.
Well, look, guys, said the president. Fair is fair. They always work on a contract, and we let his run out.
We ought to go about this logically, said Paul Goodman, who, like the president, was a lawyer and had a methodical mind. First, we ought to decide if we need a rabbi at all. Then,
what do you mean, do we need a rabbi at all? How are we going to get along without a rabbi?
Lots of places don't have them, Goodman replied. I mean, not regularly. They get a young punk down from the seminary every Friday evening and pay him maybe 50 or 100 bucks in expenses.
Sure, and you know what you get? You get a young punk.
Not just a young punk, Goodman reproved. A young rabbi punk.
Yeah, I've seen some of those guys from the seminary. A bunch of hippies, if you ask me.
Look, fellows, Bert Raymond pleaded, we can't do that. We got people who use the temple for their weddings and bar mitzvahs all year round. When they come to make arrangements, what do we tell them? Maybe we'll have a rabbi and maybe we won't? It's an all-year-round business with us, and we've got to have a rabbi full-time.
All right, so we go to the next step, said the methodical Goodman. Is it this rabbi that we want? Personally, if I've got to have some holy Joe telling me what's right and what's wrong, I'd rather have an older man. It's a matter of sentiment with me.
Well, to me, it's a matter of business. And I don't let sentiment interfere with business, said Marty Drexler, the treasurer. Now, when Bert told me about this letter, I did some checking around, and I can give you some hard facts to think about. The price of rabbis has been going up every year since World War II.
Every class graduating from the seminary has been able to command a higher starting salary than the one before. You go out in the open market to hire a rabbi with 5 or 6 years' experience like ours, and you'll pay anywhere from $3,000 to $5,000 more than we're paying right now, because he'll be somebody who's got a pulpit and will have to make it worth his while to leave. When you hire a rabbi, you're buying spiritual leadership. Now I say, why raise our spiritual leadership cost $3,000 if we don't have to?
That makes sense to me. Me too.
The president looked around the table. All right, I think we have a consensus. I think we're all pretty much agreed that right now the best thing for us to do is to continue the services of our present rabbi. So that brings us right back where we started from. What do we do about this letter? My own feeling is that Stan Agronaut is right, and that what the rabbi is interested in is a contract. How about it? You all in agreement? Again, his glance swept around the table, halting momentarily at each of them for a confirmatory nod. Only Ben Gorfinkel demurred.
It's my impression that the rabbi usually means what he says.
The president shrugged. Maybe he did when he wrote it. He may have been a little sore. To tell the truth, I thought he acted kind of sore when I told him that we weren't going to have a community seder. That may have had something to do with it, but it's my opinion that if we offer him a contract, he'll decide right quick that he doesn't really want a leave of absence. It could be, you know, that what he wants leave for is to go job hunting.
You got a point, Bert.
All right, so what kind of contract do we offer him? Ben Gorfinkel, who was last year's president, felt constrained to speak once again. He was present at the meeting only because the bylaws made all past presidents life members of the board. The other former presidents, Becker and Wasserman and Schwartz, had stopped attending after the first few meetings. This particular board, all young men, none of them over 35, consisted of close friends. They discussed temple business in the course of casual social get-togethers, so that the board meetings served little purpose beyond voting formally on what had already been decided between them. But Gorfinkel still persisted in attending, even though for the most part he kept his silence. But this was important. Slowly, deliberately, he explained to the board that at the end of the last season, the rabbi had rounded out 6 years with the congregation, and that the previous board had planned to offer him a life contract with a year's sabbatical leave for his 7th year.
But we felt that a contract like that should be negotiated by the new board rather than by the retiring board.
I don't remember running across it in the minutes of last year's meetings, said the secretary.
That's right, said Raymond. I don't recall anything like that.
Naturally, said Gorfinkel. The rabbi attended board meetings in those days. We couldn't very well discuss it at the regular meetings.
In that case, the president interjected, we have to assume that it was just something that was talked about informally by some of the members. I don't feel that we're bound by it.
I was just giving you the background, said Gorfinkel stiffly.
All right, suppose we take that as a starting point, said the president. How do you guys feel about Ben's idea of a lifetime contract and a year's sabbatical leave?
All I can say is it strikes me as a pretty sweet deal, said Agronaut. Mind you, I got nothing against the rabbi, but it's a sweet deal.
On the contrary, said Gorfinkel, it's the usual thing. The rabbi was on trial for a year, and then he was given a 5-year contract. The next one is usually a still longer contract, and in most places it's for life.
How do they work the salary on these contracts? Asked Marty Drexler. Are there annual increments, or...
I suppose, said Gorfinkel, or some arrangement for cost of living adjustments. We didn't go into it at the time.
Seems to me there's a lot of thinking we got to do about this, said Drexler. If we give him a sabbatical, we're going to have to hire a replacement while he's gone. Think about that for a while.
What are you getting at, Marty? Asked the president.
I'll tell you what I'm getting at. This is a temple, and he is a rabbi. It's religion and all that, but a contract is a business deal. I don't care who it's between. Everything has to be spelled out, and each side has to make the best deal they can. Take, for instance, what I said before about the cost of rabbis going up from year to year. That's true. But you take when a rabbi gets to be around 50, his chances of getting another job are not so good. He's like over the hill. So there he's a little weaker, and we're in a little stronger position. He's, what, 35 or so now? So suppose we offer him a 15-year contract with the idea of negotiating again when that expires.
Gee, I don't know.
That's kind of dirty. What's dirty about it? Demanded Drexler.
Stanley Agronaut waved his hand.
I want to make a motion.
What's your motion?
Just a minute, Mr. Chairman. There's a motion on the floor.
What motion?
There's no motion on the floor. We were just discussing, kind of chewing the fat.
Raymond rapped on the table with his gavel. Just a minute. Let's get organized. Nobody made a motion, so there's no reason why Stan can't make one. Go ahead, Stan.
I move, Mr. Chairman, that you appoint a committee to go and see the rabbi and kind of feel him out and get the lay of the land.
You sure it's the rabbi you got in mind, Stan?
The chairman rapped on the table. Come on, guys, get serious.
Well, to be serious, said Goodman, I'd like to amend Stan's motion and make it a committee of one, and I'd like to nominate Marty Drexler for the job.
Yeah, that's right. Let's have just one guy deal with him.
How about it? You all in favor of having one guy do the negotiating?
Right. The only way. The only fair way. One against one.
All right, said Bert Raymond. All in favor say aye. All opposed, nay.
The ayes have it, but I think maybe I ought to talk to him instead of Marty.
No, let Marty.
Why, Marty, as the president of the congregation, it seems to me that I ought to talk to him.
None of them liked to say that they were afraid he might give away too much, but Paul Goodman offered to explain.
I suggested Marty in the first place because he's the treasurer and this is definitely a money matter. Besides, Marty is in the finance business and knows all about the angles that got to do with cost of living increases and that kind of thing. But if not Marty, then it seems to me that you'd be the last one we'd want, Bert, just because you are the president. Marty or somebody else can always say he's got to check with the board for further instructions or for approval of any deal he might arrange. But anything the president proposed, we'd feel we'd have to back him up on it. And if you promised something and then we didn't back you up, it would put you in a funny spot if you had to go back and say your board wouldn't go along.
All right, said Raymond. You see the rabbi, Marty, and work something out. Chapter 3. Miriam opened the door and ushered Marty Drexler into the living room where the rabbi was sitting.
Since it's temple business, Mr. Drexler, I'll leave you to.
Well, maybe you ought to sit in on this, Mrs. Small, said Marty. In my own business, when it's family finances like our family plan loan, I always tell the client to come in with his wife, you know what I mean.
Of course, Mr. Drexler, if you prefer.
The rabbi had risen, and he now motioned their guest to a chair and then sat down himself.
This has something to do with our family finances, Mr. Drexler?
Marty Drexler smiled, a beaming loan company smile.
I'd say it has. We voted in the board to give you a contract, and Bert Raymond appointed me like a committee of one to get all the little details ironed out with you.
That's very kind of them, said the rabbi pleasantly. He leaned back in his chair and looked ceilingward. Of course, I tend to think of a contract as an agreement between two equal parties, since each has something that the other wants, rather than as something that one party confers on the other.
Drexler was determined not to be put out. He nodded.
Yeah, I guess you're right at that. I meant I'm here to negotiate it.
And why at this time? Asked the rabbi.
Drexler looked at him reproachfully.
Rabbi, he said, we're grown men. We're not a bunch of kids. We got the message. You send us a letter asking for a leave of absence. It didn't take us long to realize that you were tickling us on the contract. After all, we're all businessmen. All right, maybe we've been a little remiss. Maybe we've been sitting on our fannies. Sorry, Mrs. Small, when we should have been tending to business. But to tell the truth, we're kind of new to the game. We figured it was just like a matter of form. All right. I'm sorry. We're all sorry. Now, let's get down to business. Suppose you tell me what you have in mind, and I'll tell you what the boys figured was fair. Then, if there's a gap between us, we'll chin about it. And you feel free to talk up, Mrs. Small, because you're as much concerned as the rabbi is, I guess. Maybe even more, because I always say that it's the lady of the house that's the homemaker. She's the one who knows how much groceries the family needs and how much they're going to cost. So, you folks, lay it right on me, and then I'll tell you how the board feels. We'll work out something, and if it's different from what we had in mind, I'll discuss it with the board and then come back here and see you about it again until we get it all straightened out. Fair enough?
It's fair enough, Mr. Drexler, said the rabbi. He hesitated and tapped the arm of his chair with his fingertips as he marshaled his sentences to explain. You may find this hard to believe, Mr. Drexler, but when I sent that letter, all I was interested in was a leave of absence. That's still all I'm interested in. I haven't given any thought to the matter of a contract, and I don't think that I'm prepared to think about it right now. A leave of absence I asked for, and it's a leave of absence that I want. Drexler was still not convinced. He could not help feeling a certain admiration for the rabbi's gifts at dickering. He tried another tack.
All right, you want to play it that way, I'll go along. Let's think about it and see where it leads. You say you want a leave of absence. In your letter you said 3 months. That's still what you want?
The rabbi nodded.
So you go away for 3 months, and you'll be expecting full pay, I suppose?
As a matter of fact, I hadn't thought about it, he considered.
No, I don't think I'd be entitled to any pay under the circumstances.
Drexler was annoyed. How do you dicker with someone who doesn't want anything from you? He had planned to point out that if the temple paid him 3 months' salary, a sizable sum, they would have to have some agreement that he would make it up to them. But if he didn't expect to be paid...
Suppose we refuse the leave of absence, Rabbi.
The rabbi smiled faintly. I'm afraid I take it anyway.
You mean you'd resign?
You wouldn't be giving me any other choice.
Then does that mean if we vote the leave of absence, you're definitely coming back?
The rabbi was honestly troubled.
I don't know. I don't know how I'll feel or what I'll want 3 months from now.
He smiled.
Who of us does? But look here, that puts us in kind of a spot. I mean, we've got to hire somebody to take your place while you're gone, and if you're not sure you're coming back...
I see your problem, Mr. Drexler. All right, why don't we just assume that I'm coming back? And when I do, we can then negotiate a contract that will be mutually acceptable. He smiled. Of course, if I should not, then we wouldn't have to. The telephone rang, and Miriam hastened to answer it. She listened for a moment and then said, It's New York, David, your mother, I suppose. Why don't you take it on the extension? The rabbi excused himself and hurried out of the room. On the phone, Miriam said, Hello, mother. Everything all right?
Yes. We're fine. Yes, Jonathan is fine. Yes, David's here. He's taking it on the other phone.
She listened for the click that signaled that her husband had picked up the receiver and said, I'll say goodbye now, Mother. We've got company. She hung up and came back to where she had been sitting. She apologized to Marty Drexler for the interruption and then went on. My husband has been in Barnard's Crossing over 6 years, Mr. Drexler. In all that time, he hasn't had a real vacation. Just an occasional weekend. He's tired. He feels stale. He needs to get away from all his regular work so that he can get a chance to think. You think it's easy for me to pick up and leave for 3 months and live on our savings? You're right, I'm the homemaker. I'm the one who worries about expenses, and this trip will be expensive, just the fares.
You're planning on a tour or something?
We're going to Israel, to Jerusalem.
Oh, but look here, Mrs. Small, if it's Israel, well, I can understand that. I mean, him being a rabbi, naturally he's got to visit the place. He's probably the only rabbi around here who hasn't been yet. But look here, Don Jacobson, who's on the board, is in the travel business. I'll bet he can work out something, maybe a 3-week tour where your husband will be the guide and it won't cost him a red cent. I'll talk to him.
The rabbi returned to the room while he was speaking. To Miriam, he said, nothing important. To Drexler, he said, it's kind of you to want to arrange something, but we're planning to go there to live for a while in Jerusalem, not just to visit.
You mean just in Jerusalem? You're not going touring to see the sights? And for 3 months? Why?
The rabbi laughed shortly. It might not strike you as compelling, Mr. Drexler, but I'll try to explain. The Passover is our basic holiday. We celebrate it not merely with a service, but with an elaborate ritual so that its lesson, the philosophy on which our religion is based, will be engraved on our minds.
Oh, you still bothered about our decision to drop the congregational Seder? Well, there were sound financial...
No, Mr. Drexler, I'm not bothered by the board's decision, the rabbi assured him. There are good arguments on either side, although I might point out that it is a question on which the rabbi of the congregation would normally be consulted. Now, I was going to say that the ritual ends with a devout wish next year in Jerusalem. Well, I've made that wish at the end of every Passover Seder, but last year it was for me not a wish but a promise, a religious commitment, if you like. Drexler was impressed, and for the remaining few minutes of his visit, he was subdued and respectful. But by the time he got home, his natural cynicism had reasserted itself, and when his wife asked how he'd made out, he replied,
"He says he wants to go and live in Jerusalem for a while. It's like a religious commitment with him. Who's he trying to kid? He's just lazy and wants to goof off for a while. He saves up a little money, and now he's going to blow it."
"Well, he'll be getting his salary."
"He will not."
"You're not going to pay him his salary?" She was surprised.
"Look," said Marty, "he's taking a leave of absence. You don't pay a salary to somebody taking a leave of absence."
"That's kind of mean, isn't it? Is that what the board decided, or was it your idea, Marty?"
"Look, Ethel, it's not my money, it's the congregation's. As treasurer, I'm supposed to use it for their advantage. I can't just throw it away because it's the rabbi."
"Besides," he said,
"he suggested it himself."
She did not answer then or during the remainder of the evening when he made sporadic remarks during the TV commercial to the effect that some guys sure have it soft if they can take off for 3 months and their wives go along with the crazy idea. And,
of course, by paying his own way, he's got no obligation to us. He's probably writing to a bunch of congregations right now asking about jobs.
But later, when they were lying in bed, and he was on the point of dropping off to sleep, she said, "You know, Marty, it's crazy and all that, but it's kind of nice, too."
"What are you talking about?"
"I mean, throwing up your job and just taking off." Chapter 4.
He asked for 3 months' leave of absence, and they gave him 3 months' leave.
Harvey Cantor threw one leg over the arm of his chair, ran a hand through his brush of iron-gray hair, and focused protruding blue eyes on his brother-in-law, Ben Gorfinkel.
"So how do you figure they done him dirty?"
Harvey was a good 10 years older than Gorfinkel, in his 50s, and was married to the elder of the two sisters. He tended to patronize him just as his wife did her younger sister. As editor of the Lynn Times Herald, a local newspaper which might dismiss news of the gravest national or international importance with a paragraph, while devoting two columns to the installation of officers of the local Dorcas Society, his editorials expressed the hidebound, conservative republicanism of the owners, but in private life, he was radical, agnostic, and generally irreverent,
especially when it came to his brother-in-law's connection with the temple in Barnard's Crossing, which he found highly amusing.
But it's without pay, and the guy can't have much money saved up.
But you said that was what the rabbi said he wanted.
I said that was what Marty Drexler reported he wanted,
Ben remarked. And you think this Drexler lied? That's the moneylender, isn't it?
Great Atlantic Finance. No, I don't think he lied. He couldn't. It would be bound to come out. But a guy like Marty Drexler could maneuver the rabbi into a position where he'd pretty much have to say it. You know, are you suggesting, Rabbi, that you take off for 3 months and we hire a substitute and pay you too for not doing anything? That kind of thing.
Well, Cantor said, the rabbi is a big boy and ought to be able to take care of himself.
He's actually pretty naive about money and business. Ben shook his head. He could have had a life contract and a year's sabbatical. The board would have granted that if he had insisted.
That's what you favored? Harvey looked at his brother-in-law.
That's what the board last year agreed to offer him, Ben said. But it was at the end of the term. And on a lifetime contract, we felt that the new board should pass on it. Naturally, we thought the new board wouldn't be much different from the old. You know, each year you drop some dead wood and pick up some new people. But from year to year, it's pretty much the same. But the Raymond Drexler crowd put up a full slate and they won.
How'd they manage that?
Well, said Ben, for one thing, the congregation was pretty much split down the middle last year. There was my bunch and there was Meyer Paff's group. We had a majority, of course. That's how we got in. But it was a very slim majority, and after the trouble our kids got into, we were pretty disorganized. And frankly, not too interested in campaigning for control of the temple. I guess a lot of us were feeling sort of disenchanted with the whole business. We didn't fight too hard.
Seeing his brother-in-law's skeptical look, Ben tried to explain more fully.
We figured we didn't have to fight too hard. We thought that since the Raymond Drexler group were so young, under 35, and since they were all relatively new to the temple, most of them had only been members 2 or 3 years, we figured they wouldn't get far. But over the years, that age group had been growing in numbers in the congregation, and right now I guess there are more of them than there are of us older people. The kids grow up. People retire a lot earlier these days. There are a lot of reasons.
Harvey still looked unconvinced. Ben elaborated.
The temple was started by Jake Wasserman and Al Becker, people like that, well along in years. They had ties to the tradition, which made a temple important to them. It certainly was to Wasserman, who was a deeply religious man. Besides, in those days, when the temple was just getting started, you needed men with money, and I mean a lot of money, like Wasserman and Becker, because they were expected to dig down every now and then to pay a fuel bill or a teacher's salary out of their own pocket when the treasury was empty. They took back notes from the temple organization, but I don't think they really expected that the temple would ever be able to make good on them. And I think some of them are still outstanding. Well, you had to be well along in years to accumulate that kind of money.
That's true, acknowledged Harvey.
And then when the temple began to stabilize, I mean, when we were meeting current expenses, people like Mort Schwartz came into power. Somewhat younger men, but still pretty well-to-do, because in those days we were always having drives for funds, and you couldn't urge someone to make a big donation or pledge if you hadn't made one yourself.
Harvey raised an eyebrow in exaggerated surprise. Well, you don't have that kind of money. Or do you, Ben, and are keeping it secret? But Gorfinkel didn't react.
Ah, by the time my group came into power, he said seriously, the temple was completely in the black. What they wanted was somebody who could run things efficiently, the administrative executive type.
What about Raymond and Drexler? Aren't they administrators too?
Ben shook his head. No, they're different. They're younger, for one thing. And they're all either in the professions or in business for themselves, and they're all doing pretty well, I guess, but of course they're still on the make. And if you're a lawyer like Bert Raymond or Paul Goodman, being a big shot in an organization like the Temple is helpful. People get to know you who otherwise wouldn't. And it helps an accountant like Stanley Argonaut and the doctors and dentists who are part of the group.
You mean they're in it just for the publicity? Harvey needled him gently. Not like the rest of you?
Well, no, said Ben, ignoring the jibe at himself. That wouldn't be entirely fair. Let's just say that they're mindful of it. For the rest, I imagine that they feel their oats and want to run things. They're in town politics, too, and for the same reason or reasons.
All right,
said Harvey, getting serious at last. So what have they got against a rabbi that makes you think they want to do him dirty? Gorfinkel thought for a moment. It's a little hard to explain. For one thing, he's the same age, 35. And yet, he doesn't think the way they do at all. He's not particularly interested in money or in getting a bigger pulpit with more prestige. He's done some pretty spectacular things in the time he's been here, but he's never courted any publicity for them, not because he's modest, because he isn't, but because he doesn't think such things are important. Maybe they'd tolerate that in an older man, but not in a man their own age. You understand? Harvey nodded. I think so. There's another thing. He knows exactly what he thinks, and he doesn't hesitate to say it. You mean he's dogmatic, opinionated, stubborn? No, although it might seem that way sometimes, and maybe some people might think so. Ben laughed dryly. I thought so at one time. I remember. But it's something different, Ben went on. Old Jake Wasserman once said of him that he had a kind of radar beam of the Jewish tradition in his mind. When the congregation went off to one side or the other, he heard a beep that told him we were straying and he'd chivvy us back on course. The kids, the young high school and college kids like my Stewie, go for him in a big way. I asked Stewie about it, and he said it was because they know exactly where they stand with him. As I got it, he doesn't play up to them, and he doesn't talk down to them. I think I get the picture. So what are you worried about? Well, said Ben, for one thing, these kids don't vote. Oh, you're worried that this Drexler and his friends will maneuver him out? Said Harvey, trying to see what his brother-in-law was driving at. That and, well, Ben looked away. I wouldn't like to see him hurt. Is that all? Harvey laughed and got up from the armchair. Forget it, Ben. People like that, people with personal integrity, people like Drexler can't hurt. Chapter 5. The young graduate of the seminary was eliminated from serious consideration almost immediately. Why would he want to come in the first place? With the demand so great for rabbis, why would he want a temporary job when he could get a full-time job? He said he wants some time to look around. So can he look around in a regular job? If he should decide he wants to go someplace else, would they hold him there by force? I'll tell you why he wants this job. It must be because he can't get another one. And why should we want someone like that? Besides, he's got a beard. That's all we need is a rabbi with a beard. And his wife. Did you get a load of her? With all that mascara junk on her eyes like a raccoon, and her dress up to her pupik? Rabbi Harry Schindler, on the other hand, made quite a different impression. He was in his mid-40s and had an ingratiating and yet forceful personality. The main objection to him was that he had been out of the active rabbinate for several years. He explained it with disarming candor. Well, I'll tell you, when I got out of the seminary, I was offered this job, associate to the rabbi of this large congregation in Ohio. Now, I was told that the rabbi was going to retire in a year or two and that I would be given his job. Mind you, I wasn't just an assistant. I had the title associate rabbi. So in the middle of the second year I was there, the rabbi gets sick and I took over for the remainder of the year. Then, when the next year begins and it's time to draw up a new contract, there's a group on the board that say they ought to have an older man, but I could stay on as associate at the same salary. It's really a one-man operation, you understand, but they had me come in because the rabbi there was not in good health. Now, a man's first duty is to his family. I mean, I had a wife and family. And the associate rabbi job, the salary, I mean, just wasn't enough. Now, one thing I want distinctly understood, it was not the fault of the congregation. And it wasn't the fault of the board. It was just one of those misunderstandings that happened. Maybe it was my fault for not getting everything down in black and white, but I'm not holding the congregation to blame. This insistence that the congregation was not at fault made a great impression on the committee. So I took this selling job, and I'm not sorry I did. I sometimes think the seminary ought to require all their graduates to serve an apprenticeship of a year or two in business, so they can get an idea of how their congregation thinks, what concerns them, what bothers them, what problems they have.
I think most rabbis are out of touch with everyday life, and from where I stand, that means out of touch with reality.
How do you mean, Rabbi?
Well, take the business of our holidays. Mostly, they're 2 days, and most rabbis are pretty concerned about the observance of that second day. Now, having been in business myself, I know that sometimes it's almost impossible to take that second day off. So I can understand and sympathize when one of the congregants, who might be a big businessman, just can't make it to the temple on that second day. And I don't hold it against him. I don't take the point of view that because he's, say, an officer of the temple, he's simply got to show on both days. There was a nodding of heads, and thus encouraged, Rabbi Schindler went on. Well, I made up my mind that I was going to give it the old college try, and if God called me to serve him by engaging in business, I'd stick with it until I was successful. I worked hard, and I don't mind saying that there was many a time when I thought of going back to the safety and sanctuary of the rabbinate, but then I thought I'd be admitting defeat. Well, when I was made assistant general manager of the Northeast Ohio Territory, I figured I'd served my time and then some, and that I could now go back to the rabbinate without feeling that I was doing it because I was a failure in business. And I don't mind telling you, gentlemen, that I could make a lot more money staying on with National Agrochemical Corporation than I could hope to make in the rabbinate. But the rabbinate is my real work. I feel it's what I'm called on to do, and that's why I'm interested in this position.
But you're out of touch. You've been away.
Oh, no, I haven't. Sometimes I think I was more active after I left than while I was actively carrying on my official rabbinic duties. I was president of the local Zionist chapter. As a matter of fact, I helped start it. And I was vice chairman of the community fund for 3 years. It's all on my resume. I headed up the ecumenical committee. That's a group that was out to bring about better relations between Jews, Catholics, and Protestants. I was on the visiting committee of the Slocum General, that's the town hospital, and for 3 years I was the panel chairman of the Kiwanis Bible study class, which used to meet every other Thursday right straight through the year, winter and summer. And I guess you gentlemen can figure out who did most of the talking in that class. And then I don't need to tell you that whenever I had to go out of town, the first thing that went into my overnight bag was my tallis and tefillin. Because in resigning from my job as rabbi, I wasn't resigning from being a good Jew. And I wish I had a nickel for every time I led the prayers in the minyan of some small town and the number of times they asked me to give a little sermon. In the small towns of Northeast Ohio, I was known as the traveling rabbi. And of course, through natural inclination, I kept up with my studies all the while, he added, to touch all rabbinic bases. The committee was taken with Rabbi Schindler, but as they discussed him, second thoughts began to develop. Not that they doubted his ability as a preacher. They had been more than satisfied with the sample, taped sermons he had sent them, which had led to his being called in the first place. Nor could they cavil at the impression he had made during the interview. He had been straightforward, self-possessed, and sincere, like a good salesman who believed in his product and had gone to the trouble to make adequate preparation for his presentation.
Of course, we'd want to check with his congregation.
I don't know that we could get much out of them. It's been 8 years since he left. Chances are that the same guys might not even be there.
Well, at least we ought to try to get a line on him from National Agrochemical, said Drexler.
Gosh, we can't do that, Marty, said Raymond. He's still working for them. They might not like it if they thought he was looking around for another job. You know how these companies are.
But we can't just take him on his own say-so. The whole story could be made up,
Drexler insisted. Well, we know he's a rabbi because it was the seminary that gave us a line on him, right? And we know he can preach because there's those sermons on the tapes. And we're all agreed he looked good to us.
That's right, but there's something that bothers me, said Arnold Bookspan. Those tapes, they were made right in the synagogue, right?
So how come he made them?
What do you mean?
I mean, why should a rabbi make a tape of his sermon?
Well, a lot of rabbis, they want to have a record.
Yeah, but then they write them out first. I mean, that if he was making tapes of his sermons, maybe he was already looking for a job back then and was making them to send out to congregations that might be interested in hiring.
You got a point there, Arnold,
Yeah, but that could have been toward the end, said Barry Meisner, who was in the insurance business,
when he was looking around, and that would be all right in my book. I tell you frankly, I'm sold on a guy. I can just see myself acting the same way he did. I've been in positions where I've had a deal going and it's crapped out through some misunderstanding that was nobody's fault, really, and I've had to rethink the whole business and start on a new tack. We all have. And then we go ahead on the new angle, and plenty of times it works out even better than if the original deal had gone through as planned. So I can see myself in the picture he painted. And I can see myself working up a presentation for this meeting same way he did. And I'd plan it out pretty much the same way.
Well, maybe that's what gets me, Bookspan insisted. I mean, like you say, if I were going to sell a couple of gross of raincoats to some big outfit where I'd never called before, I'd do it just this way. I think, I hope, I'd be as smooth as this guy.
So?
So that's the trouble with him. He's just like us.
So we're back where we started from. You know, all this takes time, and we don't have too much time, Raymond observed.
The boys were the salt of the earth, but sometimes it was hard to get them to come to a decision, especially when he tried to get complete agreement. Division, he felt, with one group voting down the other side, just made for bad feelings.
Yeah, but we can't just take anybody, said Bookspan.
I'm not so sure. It's only for 3 months.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.